to make sure you get Town and Country magazine. There's a wonderful article called Fashion and Style News, and he's one of the six innovators, progressive designers. He is one of the designers paving the way for the fashion future, and we sure need that because it's not very creative out there, but we're glad we have Narciso as one. And what they say about him is wonderful, too. The signature collection, he wowed everyone ever since, and he's continuing to be as creative and innovative with his simple line, his the purity, and we just love him. That's all. Get the Town and Country magazine, because this is very special. And put it in your scrapbook of good designers. And there's another article I just received from Heather. She cut out of Vogue. So he's one of the highlighted designers of our time. And I can't keep telling you what I think of him. He's very special. And anyway, I'm not going to waste time because I see it's already after 4. I'd love to have Narciso come right up and take over.
Star.
Well, you're a superstar.
Oh, I love you. I pay her to say all those things. She promotes the name, right? Hi. Nice to be here. Thank you for that build up. I hope I can live up to that. I'm a little nervous, but I'm always a little nervous before, you know, when I have to speak to people. You can go. Do you want to stay? Is that loud enough? Hi, and I'm very happy to be here, and I don't know what I'm supposed to say every time I get a build up from Alice like that, but I'm very happy to be here and have you ask questions, because I guess, there's a question right there. It's not a brief history anymore. It's been it feels like a million years. I studied at Parsons, and I didn't hand in my field trip at all. I know, they're still waiting for it. And they remind me every so often. But I went to Parsons, and then I was very lucky, and I worked for Donna Karan while she was at Anne Klein. And that lasted, she had gone to do her own company, and I stayed at Anne Klein with Louis DeLolio. And that was a great experience because Louis is a great tailor, and I learned a lot about, you know, it was my first job, so I learned a lot, period. And then I got to go and work 4 years at Calvin Klein, which was another fantastic experience because there were really, really amazing people who worked there. And, I didn't think back then when I worked there 7 days a week, 24 hours a day, that it was all that fun. But now when I look back on those days and what I learned and the people that I met and the things that I did, it was really a great time in my life. I mean, it was a big party, actually. And then what did I do? And then I left Calvin and I went to work at, I started to consult here in New York for, actually I was working for Say Cashmere in New York, and consulting for Nino Cerruti in Paris, and it sort of worked out that I had this consulting agreement for 2 days a month, but it turned into like 2 weeks out of the month, and so I was spending time there and here, and ultimately I just continued to work in Paris and stopped consulting for Say. Everything had changed, and that was great, because to work in the United States is a very, I mean, to work, to have the experience of learning from two great companies like Anne Klein and Calvin Klein was amazing, because I learned a lot about the business, and it's a very different side to fashion than what Europe represents to fashion, or what fashion represents to Europe. And when I started to work there, it was funny, because I had come from this great American sportswear background and a more business-like background than they had in Europe at the time. And so I thought that, you know, everybody in Paris was showing the wildest stuff and was incredibly creative and very different, and they pride themselves in that sort of having a very different, a very creative edge to the fashion culture there. And so I thought it was very funny that the most avant-garde thing that you could show in Paris were clothes that you could actually wear. So I did that, and it did get a lot of attention, and that was fun while it lasted, which led me to then open my own company. And it's unbelievable, because I lost track of time at some point, and I think now it's about 9 years. I should say 10, but it's kind of hard to say 10. 10 feels like you should do something, like have a party. But you know, we're too busy to have a party. So it was, that's sort of the road. And in the mix there, after I started my own business, I was consulting with Loewe in Spain, which is a brand that LVMH owns. And that was a real challenge. That was really, of all of the positions that I've ever held, that was the most challenging. But it was a great experience as well, because I got to work in Madrid, and I got to meet amazing people and make friends that I have today. You know, they're part of my life. So that was cool. Ba-dum-bum. Yeah? Made up? No, I think people use that description a lot, and have for a really long time. I mean, I've always liked architecture, and I like the way architects think, mostly. And when you think about how an architect constructs a house or a building, you have to think of people living in it, and you have to think of how it lasts. And because we can create something that'll last for a certain amount of time, or people will use it for a certain amount of time, but something that people are going to function in, like this room, it has to last through a longer period of time. And also the materials, and how there's a much more intellectual way to build something, and a new way to build something, instead of just, you know, you're gonna make a shirt, and then this year you're gonna make it in red and put a flower on it and to make it different. And I think the approach that architects use is fantastic, the way they choose materials and put it all together. is a very curious thing. Sure. Next. Oh, hi. Not so much working in Spain. I mean, as I said, it was an amazing experience, and I made a great friends in Spain. But culturally, to be brought into a company that you have no sort of, it wasn't like I went to Loewe and met Mr. Loewe, and he said, "You're the perfect designer for this company," and we sort of came together. You know, I had been working in Europe. I didn't really know what Spanish fashion was and what the brand actually meant to the Spanish, especially in Madrid, because it's a company that was it's a very historic company that had that had made gloves for the king in 150 years ago, and there was a certain amount of respect that you had to have for the people who worked there and for what the company represented to them. And to the city and to the country. And, you know, it was very difficult for me because I was American and I was brought in here, in there, because I had a Spanish name. And then I had to show whatever I created for them in Paris to be critiqued by the international press. So the international press critiques you on whether it's good or bad. They don't care what the history is or what's available to you or how you're working or where you're working. So it was a puzzle. You know, the French wanted one thing. They sort of expected another. I don't feel that I could do it all, you know. So thank you, good question. Hi. Yes? Yeah, when I started my company, it was the first season I showed in Milan. I actually showed there for 4 years, and that was good. I mean, the reason I had shown in Milan was because from the time I left Cerruti to the time that I think I left in maybe March. And by September, I was showing again. I didn't miss a season, because I really didn't want to miss a season. And to do that, I could only show in Milan. That was hard too, because to work overseas and be based here is a challenge. You know, unless you have a very big team. And back then it was only me, so that ended too. Now I'm very happy to be here in New York, and you know, it's my home, and it's where I create the best.
We're all happy you're here.
Oh, cool. Yeah? Oh, this is better over here. More obstacles? Did you hear her? No, she asked if I felt that being a Latino, I had more obstacles in my career than non-Latinos, right? I guess back when I was younger, there was a, growing up, when I was very little, we lived in a very blonde community, so I did experience what it is to be the odd man out. But in my career, I've never really let anything get in the way. I think sometimes we have a label that people give us, and then you sort of feed into that, you know, I can't have that, or I can't do that, or I can't be that because I'm, you know, short, gay, Latin, whatever it is that people give themselves. And that's just, I didn't, I never thought of myself as anything but wanting to do what I do. So I never let anything get in my way, especially not my Latin roots, as a matter of fact. I mean, it's curious. Once I did a charity show in Venezuela, which was an amazing kids charity I wanted to help out. And when I went down there and showed the collection that I had shown in Italy at the time, it was very muted and white and silver. And they freaked out because they said, how could you? I mean, they really freaked out. They were like, this is crazy. This is just absolutely crazy. How can you call yourself a Latino? Where is the red? Where are the ruffles? That's a true story. I mean, there was one press person who was literally like shaking. He was like I had insulted my heritage or my background or something. It was kooky. But it was very funny. And then, you know, here and in Europe, it's a very sort of, in Europe they would say, oh, the Cuban designer. So they all thought I was from Cuba. So that was something exotic. And the Americans used to say that I was European or Spanish and that I lived in Spain. And I don't know. The Latins, I don't know. They couldn't. It's funny when you do something new. I mean, I always think of what I do as something very easy and accessible to women, and you know, that you could have it be in a room and it's not screaming. You know, if it was something I did was sitting in that audience, it wouldn't be jumping out at you. And I love that. I love to do that, and I try to do that. But sometimes when you do things that aren't expected of you, people don't like it. People say, you know, it's not Latin, it's not, they don't know how to they don't know how to pigeonhole you or put you in the box that they've built for, you know, your last name, which is Rodriguez. So if it's Rodriguez, it should be red. And if it's, you know, Bill Blass, it should be beige. Very funny. You can do whatever you want. Sure. Oh, the fragrance? Sure. This young lady asked how the fragrance was born and would I like to do more of that. I loved, you know, ever since, I was very young and I loved fragrance. I made stuff with different oils and it's always been something that's I've enjoyed personally, like the allure of my mother's Chanel bottle and the smell of it and the white box and, you know, the things that impress you when you're a child and as you go along. My uncle was a big, like, he lived for any new fragrance that was going to come out. So he had everything, like, and I was lucky enough to play with all of it. Things that I had never heard of. Things from Europe that I didn't know existed. And so I had I learned a lot about fragrance. And then I've always loved musk and oils and things like that. And really, this was born years ago. You know, it's like something, like the bottle idea I had picked up in Japan when I was in my early 20s. You know, it was a bottle that I loved and was very beautiful to me. And then 20 years later, I happened to go, when I was designing a bottle, I gravitated towards that bottle. So completely unknowingly too, because I had given it to my mom as a gift, and one day visiting her, I said, where'd you get that? It looks like my new fragrance bottle. And she said, you gave that to me when you went to... Yeah, so it's like the consistency of having that one thing that you've always wanted to do. And I had a really good time convincing people to do it. And I didn't have a good time convincing, I had a good time building the fantasy. Convincing them to do it was another story. You know, I mean, especially today, the fragrance industry, they market things and they study things to death, and then whoever sold the most fragrances last week is the fragrance that they're copying this week. So I didn't want to do that. I wanted to do the exact opposite of what the market trend was. And they, you know, again, they didn't know how to accept that or process it. And but you know, I forced them to with a lawyer, and then and now it's, you know, very successful. I see, you know, I hear from all these different young ladies like you that know the fragrance. I mean, I was surprised that you mentioned it, but it's around the world. I mean, I was in Russia not so long ago, and I saw this big stand and people talking about it. And it was really nice. It was really nice because, for me, I'm a firm believer that anything you do that's born from passion and that you really love is successful. Whether it sells, I mean, that's a different story. But if you do it, you know, if you create it and whether it's, you know, a garment or a shoe or a bag or a fragrance, and you really feel it, that, you know, it was something that you wanted to do, then it's really a successful thing. Yes, yes, and yes. The design the easy ones first. Yes, I'm doing menswear for spring, and yes, where can you find it? Is Barney's in New York. And the design process for men, and yeah, I mean, it's I think that people generally want to look good, feel good, and be attractive and sexy to other people. I mean, it's like a very simplistic sort of approach. And in that way, the menswear and the womenswear is very traditional or classic or easy on the eyes. You know, it doesn't have to be anything something that makes you feel really good and makes you feel good when you put it on. I mean, I'm sure you experience that when you get dressed. You have one pair of pants that you put on, and for some reason they make you feel much better than the same pair of pants in the closet next to them. And it's based on that philosophy, and they should function, be well made, and last, and very easy. So in those respects, they share a lot of similarities, and I build both of them simultaneously because I think it's one thing. I don't think it's one thing from the first season. And I was surprised, and I learned when the response was, "Wow, it looks like the man that would go with that woman," because I never really thought about him being somebody else, and that people recognized that and said it to me. It was like, oh, I didn't think of that, but when I look back on the collection, yeah, it did make sense. And I think for fall it was a little bit more evolved, and then hopefully for spring, if I make it through the spring season, it will be a little bit more evolved too. Thanks for your question.
Mm-hmm. How you decided to do that, and if you confronted any challenges, or tell us a little about
I know. I'm on it. I interviewed a lot of these people. Accessories accessories today are really what the market and the world is interested in, for every dress you might sell, it's much easier, much more financially rewarding to sell 100 bags. it's very funny, but I mean I'm not involved with a big accessories manufacturer. So the way that I've done my shoes and bags has always been as a direct link to the collection, and just as the menswear is another piece of that puzzle, I always see the bag or the shoe or the hat as the thing that is finishes the look and is part of one vision. So my accessory business is very, very small compared to all those huge lines of bags, because I don't know. Again, it's like I think those are great things, and I appreciate them. But there's also things that need to be, for me, a little bit more humble and not the thing that you see that everybody has, or logo or advertising driven, there are people who still appreciate craftsmanship and the craft and doing things in materials that are beautiful and not have all the bells and whistles and things. There are people who just don't want the noise. I don't want it, obviously. I just don't. I don't want that. And I don't think like that. And I don't think the women who appreciate my work and wear my clothing want that from me. So. Yeah? Oh, good. I said something smart. Do I pass? I pass? I get an A? Great. Thank you. Cool. Finally, I got promoted. Yeah? No, I haven't. No, I mean, I think, I love to do my work, and I love to do it in a very controlled way, because when you have a lot of companies that reach to just put their name everywhere, I think it's great if that's what you want to do. I'm sure you've seen there are stores and they sell keychains and everything. You can put a designer's name on anything, like a doggy bed and, whatever you want, basically, because it's selling the name. And I don't really like to work like that. I mean, I've turned down amazing opportunities that my friends always go, how did you do that? Like, how could you walk away from that money or that thing? And part of that has been that doing other collections that I wouldn't be able to work on or create. Because it's really fun for me. And part of the reason I do this is, to choose materials and cut them and make things and build the business like that. And then when you have other collections where other people design other things and present them to you and put your name on them. I never understand that, but I'm dumb that way. I don't know. Maybe one day I'll change my mind. Don't? Okay, I won't. Somebody had a hand somewhere. Hi. Sure. I mean, I do love the accessories portion of the collection. And recently, I hired a CEO to help me run the business, which is, you know, it's so, for so many years, I've been the designer and the president that it astounds me that it's 10 years, because I was so focused on, you know, you have to get through the first 5 years. You know, and if you pass that, then you're sort of okay, and you're not going to go out of business and all of that stuff that, you know, the rules of the game are. And I was so focused on 5 years that it became 10 years. And but along with that, there's so much work, you know, lawyers and, you know, just business stuff that I've been taking care of that I just don't want to do it anymore. And my focus is to let him do that part of my job from now on and focus more on growing the accessories and having the luxury of time to be able to sketch and work with people on my team that are, you know, that we collaborate on these things together, and I learn from them and they learn from me. That's what I want to do. You know, I want to take more pictures. I love taking pictures. And a lot of my inspiration comes from seeing things around, you know, the city or around the world or wherever I am. And so I want to do a lot more of that. I want to create more. And I think when you create, that's when you see your business grow. Sure, thank you. Hi. In terms of inspiration, how important is traveling in regards to inspiration around the world? You know, I think traveling. I think any travel that you do at any point in your life is a something that you learn from. And for me, you know, any trip that I've ever taken abroad, I've always been curious to see the underground as well as the fashion high street and the stores. And I like to see restaurants. I like to see mainly people, you know, how they move, how they go to work, how they live. The architecture. So, yeah, I guess it is very important to travel and to see other things. But I'm the kind of person who'd be very happy to travel on his bicycle through the East Village, though. You know, and I can see a million things that'll inspire me there. Sure. Was that a good answer? Was it vague? Yes and yes. Yes and no. Yeah? Huh? Who are my mentors? Who are my heroes? Who do I admire? Who did I learn from? I learned a lot from Zach Carr. I don't know if you've ever heard of Zach. He was the designer at Calvin Klein and a really, really talented individual who had amazing taste. There's actually a book about him that his brother produced not very long ago that you should look at, because he was brilliant. He was really, really brilliant. He knew everything about fashion. He knew every little detail about Chanel, her personally, and her work. He knew, I mean, he just knew everything. He knew every artwork, every country. He sketched everything that he saw, and it was beautiful. And he taught me a great deal. I mean, he was a man of great taste and very funny. And he had worked at Calvin, I don't know, 20 years maybe. And I knew of him. He had actually given me a tour of Calvin Klein when I was in school. And he was a great guy, and he became one of, I guess, the most influential person in my life as far as my craft, because he was a great, he knew the craft, and he respected other designers and what they did. Brilliant guy. Get that book. It has his name, Zach Carr. C-A-R-R, right? C-A-R-R. Z-A-C-K-C-A-R-R. Did you know Zach? Amazing guy. Questions? Regrets in my career? Millions. I mean, you could say that. You hear that cliche, never any regrets and all that nonsense. Of course, I mean, everybody, both professionally and personally, has regrets and triumphs. So nothing so major. You know, I think if you get to a certain, I think if you love what you do and you get to do it for most of your life, it's a great career, you know. I mean, I'm always really, really happy and walk to work with a smile on my face. And last night we were in the office till so late. Oh my God, we were so late. We were having so much fun. It was just three of us. And we had all the spotlights on, and we were just huddled around the boards for next spring. And we were tired, and we had worked late Saturday night too. But when I walked out to the front and came walking back, I looked at the whole scene, you know, and I thought, this is really awesome. And I called them over and I was like, look at this. It looks like a picture of what, you know, the fantasy is, a designer's office or studio. And it was true. It was just it's a very humble studio. It's not grand at all, but it's just wonderful. And I always walk to work with a smile on my face. So I guess I can't say I regret anything. I made mistakes. I didn't make them. Huh? Oh, I don't mind. Yep. Little sleep. Yeah, you should forget about sleeping. Yeah, I mean, I think it also comes with responsibility. You know, I have the responsibility of the company and, you know, all of the things that I have to get accomplished during the course of the day. But I've never been a very good sleeper, so I guess the career suits me. Yeah, it's tough. When I left Calvin Klein, he was really funny because towards the end of my working there, we weren't really that friendly. You know how that is when you're working for somebody. And then when I resigned, he was very nice, and he said, "Oh, really? Did you have to go?" And was very nice about all of that stuff. And I said, "No, I'm going." And then he said something that has really stayed with me, and he was very nice about it. He said, "You know, it's not an easy career that we've chosen." And then he said, "But I really have faith that you can do it." And I knew it wasn't an easy career because I worked for him, and it was really tough. No, Joe, I'm joking.
Not really.
No. No, it isn't. I mean, it's really hard. I mean, the people that work with me work so hard. I'm always like, oh God, why do they do that? Like, I know why I do it, but they love it too, and they love working in that environment. And you don't mind not sleeping when you're obsessing about, should it be longer, should it be shorter? What did I pay that bill? All that kind of stuff. Yeah? Like you? What advice would I give? Just, jump and don't look back. Because you really, if you look back, you run scared. It's a very hard industry, and it's a very tough business climate for designers today. There are really huge talents out there that have never been commercially successful, but they are the most talented people out there. So you have to. I guess the wisest advice that I could give someone is to, think about what path you'd like to go in, and just go on that one path. I mean, if you want to work in Europe, or if you want to create your own label, I never wanted to have my own company. Everybody, when I was in school, everybody wanted to just run out the front door with their diploma and open up a company. And I was like, no, I want to learn. I really want to learn. And I learned from great, great people. That's also very good advice. I made a lot of mistakes, but on somebody else's time. I learned a lot. It's great. Just get as much experience as you can. Yeah? Neither am I. Yeah, I'm not really afraid of losing that, because I would never do what they did. it's as simple as that. I remember when Halston, who I considered always one of the greatest designers and I really admired, couldn't work anymore because he had sold his name. And that was heartbreaking, because when you have somebody that talented whose name is now represented at JCPenney, it was really bizarre. And I think that there were so many other people that came along after that for money or building a company had sold a part of their name to the wrong person. And I've always kept 100% ownership of my name, and I just think, after seeing especially what happened to Hellman and Jill, I'm really grateful that I own that, It's tough. I mean, I can't imagine what it would be like to wake up and not be able to have my workroom around the corner and make clothes. I don't care, money doesn't drive me, and fame doesn't drive me, and there are things that came along the way that are nice, but they're not the reason that I get up in the morning. I get up and I love to look at all of those colors and all of those fabrics and cut them and make things out of them. So if I couldn't do that, I'd be lost, because I can't be an accountant, because I can't count to save my life. And, oh, yes, thank you so much for supporting me. Everything is so appreciated. Yeah. Yeah, part of, you know, and then you have to give. You know, you have to give back. Always. I mean, I think that's so important. And we try. I try personally. I love kids so much, and I try to help children as much as I can, whether it be in Latin America or here or anywhere actually. But I try to focus on, you know, certain groups. And this year I got involved with a great organization that's called Aid for AIDS, and they're participating in the AIDS walk. So I took it upon myself that I should walk, and contacted everybody that I know in the industry to really support this great organization that helps people with HIV and AIDS in Latin America and the Caribbean. Oh, right, we have a video. I totally forgot. There's a video of the last show. Sure. What? Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, it's kind of, well, it would be, it's a very strange question for me to answer. It's not a odd question for you to ask at all. But, you know, Carolyn was someone who I was very close to. And so to make her a dress like I had before was something very personal. It just happened to be that dress was on, I don't know, something like 3 million newsstands, you know, full, you know, like life-size pictures around the world. And I remember Anna Wintour said to me that like nobody can achieve that today. Nobody gets that. And yeah, so a lot of people learned my name because of that. And I have a weird feeling about it because so many designers would have loved to have designed that dress for personal, you know, for their business gains, but I didn't do it for that. I did it for someone who I loved very much. I still love very much. So, yeah, big break. Roll them? I mean, I guess they can watch the show and maybe ask a couple more questions after the show, if that's okay with you, if you'd like to. Mark? He fell asleep. I talked for too long. We'll be right back.
And he walked up and told her, thinking maybe it'd pass. And they talked and looked away a lot doing the dance. Her hand brushed up against his, she left it there. Told him how she felt and then they locked in a stare. They took a step back, thought about it, what should they do? Cause there's always repercussions when you're dating in school. But their lips met and reservations started to pass. Whether this was just an evening or a thing that would last, either way he wanted her and this was bad. Wanted to do things to her, it was making him crazy. Now a little crush turned into a like, and now he wants to grab her by the hair and tell her, I want to hold you close, skin pressed against me tight. Lie still, close your eyes girl, so lovely it feels so right. I want to hold you close, soft breath beating hard, as I whisper in your ear, I wanna fucking tear you apart.
Like that, it was the color was a bit, well, there was no color, it was not very, it's a bit off, but I hope that you enjoyed that. I like the music, and if you have any other questions, sure. No, I think I'd like to start with fabrics first, and I visit a lot of the fabric mills in Italy and pull as much stuff as possible. And things that I had in mind, I think I sort of look for materials that do what I feel. Like if I feel soft or structure or color and you go and you sort of look through things and you will naturally gravitate towards the things that you feel, and then find new things too, or just completely throw away everything that you had in mind and then you go back and start. I think it's hard to sketch first, and you know, if you don't have something in your head that you're gonna make it in. This was actually a new venue. I was showing in the tents for some time, but I wanted to move away from the tent a little bit because I just felt there's so many people were showing there, especially you know now there are so many collections and celebrities showing there, and I didn't want to be one more person there. So the past two seasons we've shown in studios across out of the tents. That light is a killer. Oi. How do I choose the models? We have before the show a big casting and everybody comes. And you know, I like them all, so, and then when we started to do menswear, that was even more fun, because it was like, It's really fun because you get to meet so many people that are kids, that are interesting, have a great spirit, and they come in wearing the craziest things, and they're beautiful and funny. And you know, when you're working so hard on a collection, and then you get to that point, and you get to see what you created on all of them, it's really fun. So, I mean, I like an eclectic group, and I get to work with really great casting directors. I have one in particular who works on a lot of different things. So she knows I like, you know, Brazilian guys, and she has a lot of those guys, and blonde girls and Brazilian girls and Asian, and it's everybody comes in, and it's so much fun. Yeah? Oh, oof. My greatest accomplishment? Oh, God. Greatest accomplishment. I don't really... Accomplishment? That's a tough one. I don't know. You know, they're very, very personal things. Very, very personal things. I mean, never... I'm not career-oriented or... You know, people, I think, set themselves, you know, have goals for their career, or, you know, I'm going to be rich by 40 was my favorite one. And I never understood why you had to be a millionaire before 40. And I worked for somebody who used to tell me that all the time, and I was like, that is the weirdest thing to say. I mean, okay, good for you. Bizarre. No, I mean... Greatest combat. The one thing, yeah, they're personal. I feel really awkward talking about it. Next question. Next question. Good question, though. Stump me. I know she. You want to raise your hand? You can. Oh, okay. It was kind of like that. I want to raise my hand, but I'm not. Yep. Yeah. Yeah, I don't really, I didn't have a choice. I think about last night and how funny I said, could you imagine if we had to sit in a cubicle from 9 to 5? You know, I can't even imagine. But even when I was very, very young, I remember I was very, very young and I fell down a flight of stairs because I was wearing my mother's high heels. I guess that was the indicator as to where I was headed. But that's a true story. I think there's a picture of that. And there's another great one of me sitting, I'm sure there's one of you too, sitting under one of those hair dryers. Yeah. Before your time, the hair dryer. Remember those hair dryers? You only see in movies now? That's cool. It was too hard. But then I didn't know then how hard fashion was. No, I think it takes a different kind of person. You know, and I realized that maybe I wanted to make something and I thought it was a house or a building, but it really was a dress. So I think it's you know, I think architecture and fine art and fashion and anything like that is so. I also studied commercial art and I loved fashion illustration and the work of Antonio Lopez and all those amazing illustrators, and you know, that was going to be my job for a while. But really, by the time I was 14, I was like, no, what was I thinking? And then I went right into fashion. But it's so closely connected. There are quite a few architect fashion designers out there. Ferré was an architect, Gianfranco Ferré was an architect, and quite a few people have made the switch. Good luck. I saw her first, sorry. how do I decide if I want to have something in my collection? Right. It's always different. You know, it's never the same, but I don't really, you know, I just make what I feel, and then that becomes the line. And again, you know, there's only so much time, and the budget only allows for so much, so I only make what I need. I don't have the luxury of, you know, having people making dresses for months and then saying, I want these three. I hate excess like that. You know, it's got to be what you want, and you should know what you want. Like when you go to a restaurant, you should ask for only what you want, because they're not going to make you three things to decide. It's like that. Choose. You know, there are a lot of things that I love to do. You know, I love to take pictures. I said that, and I love to sketch, and I would love to find a time to paint again. I like the idea that I'm gonna ride my surfboard, but I'm not really, because I'm never gonna get down to the beach. I would love to do something really different. You know, I love South America a lot. I travel to Brazil a great deal, and I love discovering very different parts of that country. That country is, I mean, I've been around the world, not to sound cheesy, but I've been around the world, but I feel the most at home besides here. But she's clapping, she's from Brazil. Just because I feel very comfortable there, and the nature and the beauty of the country I find astounding. So I'm always trying to discover new parts of it, and it's so huge. If you go to the south, it's one way, and if you go to the north, it's another way, and completely different food and people, and I would, you know, ultimately maybe like to live there. Or spend more time there, and you know, there's a million things that I've yet to do besides surf. I'd like to get involved more in more charities, that's for sure. I mean, I've done a lot of things through the years, but I don't know, this particular one has really touched me, because it's. Children and families, and I don't know, it's a good thing. Hi, yeah. I'm sorry, I couldn't hear you. I don't use forecast services. I remember there were some companies that I worked for that had them or had associations with them, but I wouldn't really know what they, you know, how they work so well. And nobody's ever asked me to use one so far, but I'll ask them if they want me to. I mean, maybe it'll make it easier.
So, like, what exactly is your role in my process? Like, you sketch, and they train you. So, like, what exactly do you do in terms of
development? I choose the fabrics and the colors, and I sketch. I can drape ideas, and I have two really amazing pattern makers that bring it closer to a reality, not just an idea. and then I fit on a human being. Oh yeah, yeah, I do all that. That's really doing it. That's the good part. That's the part I would really love to do more of, and there's never enough time to do that. What do I like least? I think it's like the business side of it. I mean, I'm curious, and I've done it for a long time, and I think any good designer today knows his business and knows about business. But sometimes it's really nice just to, you know, like on weekends when there's nobody there and it's just a few of us and we're focused on the work is when it all happens, or at night. I wish that the process was, you know, the way it is on the weekends. I'm always saying how we should not come in like Monday and Tuesday and just work Saturday and Sunday. But we always come in Monday and Tuesday too, because you have to.
So.
Yes? Right. I'm sure it's the way of the future. I'm still going to do it by hand. And, you know, you can, we create perfect a lot of patterns on computer, and that, the speed is amazing. You know, the amount of speed and just, remember, all my life on 7th Avenue, and even in Europe, there were all those racks and racks of paper patterns, and that just doesn't exist anymore. And I'm so grateful to have that dust out of the office. Everything's on computer now, and you could just push a button and print out your whole collection. But to fit it, no computer is ever going to do that. I hope. I'm not bothered by it. I mean, I find inspiration in the computer, because it's just such a, I mean, it's you can access the world. I don't think anybody in our craft or anybody who loves the craft is gonna lose their hands to a computer, I think, right? They can't do what we do, right? And they can't think. It's just another tool now. It's like the phone or the TV, or they can't think. Don't worry. The day the computer starts thinking, it's like all those movies when the computers take over the world. Is that it? Thank you so much. Good luck.